Welcome to the last talk today. This is a work in progress talk about analysis of monitoring data. So understanding KO can be beneficial in many aspects. It can help to procure right storage systems, develop better job scheduling strategies, for example, to avoid running two IO intensive jobs in parallel. We can also use this knowledge to find applications that need some kind of IO optimization. It can also help to analyze 10,000 of jobs and to pick automatically jobs with some specific IO behavior, for example, misbehaving jobs. So at the CARCET, we have a monitoring system that provides IO data. It captures 9 IO metrics in intervals of 5 seconds. So 5 metrics are metadata metrics and 4 data metrics. The captured data is 4-dimensional because we capture data from allocated nodes, available file systems, 9 metrics, and during whole runtime. So analysis of such data is complicated. So we decided to do some simplifications. Firstly, we aggregate data to 10-minute intervals. Then we categorize I/O performance into 3 categories: low I/O, high I/O, and critical I/O. So high I/O is between 0.99 quantile and 0.99 quantiles, and critical I/O is behind the 0.99 quantile. But these are details. You can find them in our previous work if you like. So here's an example of categorized monitoring data. This representation has many advantages. So Unix disappeared completely. We do not have megabytes per second or operations per second anymore, and we can now aggregate data in many different ways that we that been not possible before. That data size shrunk from several gigabytes to a few megabytes, so that we can share it with you, and data processing can be done much faster. So we downloaded monitoring data from 1 million jobs. 580,000 of them have significant IO. So that means that they have at least one high I/O or a critical I/O as a segment. So and we have created 4 different data sets out of this data. One of them contains job metadata, and the other 3 contains job I/O metrics, job I/O duration, and job callings. The data set can be downloaded from the Git repository. So job metadata contains anonymized user data, job configurations, and runtime statistics. So unfortunately, I couldn't anonymize job names. This is quite a difficult task because many job names are generic. I simply couldn't guarantee that job names are properly mapped to the anonym version. So the intention of metadata is the usage with other data sets. It can be joined with other data sets by the job ID. So IO metrics are a result from our previous work. We defined the 3 key metrics that are specific for parallel jobs and that can be computed from the categorized data that are job IO balance and job IO utilization and job IO problem time. Job I/O balance metric indicates how I/O load is distributed between nodes during job runtime. And job utilization shows the average I/O load during I/O phases. And job I/O problem time is the fraction of job runtime that is I/O intensive. It is approximated by the fraction of segments that are considered I/O intensive. So, but you can look in our previous work if you like. So the next data set is job IO duration. It is an experimental data set. It describes the fraction of runtime that the jobs spent doing a particular IO. The example visualizes only a fraction of the data set. So columns beginning with zero describe how much time the job spent doing low I/O, and columns beginning with one describe how much time a job spent doing I/O, high I/O, and columns beginning with four describe how much a job spent doing critical I/O. So also the dataset contains 27 features, so but I couldn't put them on the slide. So okay, job codings. So job coding is job codings in the context of these presentations are compact representations of the categorized monitoring data. The purpose is to reduce dimensionality of data and to make data suitable for the algorithms. So we investigated two coding styles. One of them is the so-called absolute mode coding. It is a sequence of numbers where each number encodes all metrics in a segment. That means that this number is reversible. Having only this number, we can say which metric was used. And then hexadecimal coding, we encode each metric with our average scores. That means that we aggregate nodes in file system dimensions. But let's take a look at them in the next slides. So at the absolute coding. So absolute mode coding was like a Linux file permissions. But instead of 3 bits, we have a 9-bit number where each position represents a metric. If a metric is used, that means if it has a high or critical I/O, the value is set to 1, and otherwise it's 0. So, and we can convert this 9-bit number to a decimal representation, and we obtain the map on the right side. So on the right side, you can see a metric and the corresponding number. So assume we want to encode a metadata read and read bytes metrics. We just look up in the table. So and so add this value 16 and 32 and obtain the value 48. So in the example. In the example, if you pick a number from the coding below, for example, 96, at the fourth position, you can compute that the job was reading the data. So, you can reverse to number 96 to read bytes and read calls. So, and the hexadecimal coding describes the average values that were obtained by aggregating nodes in file system dimensions. After aggregating the dimensions and computing the mean value, we obtain so a floating number between 0 and 4. So because maximum score is 4. So and what we do next, we do a kind of a quantization. So we map this floating point number to a hexadecimal number. So on the slide you can see the function. It's just multiplication of the mean value by 4 and then we round the value, and then we obtain the hexadecimal represent number. So below is an example. Here you can see that this job was creating files in the beginning and did some metadata modifications. So and then in the second half, so it read the data. So So, we did some analysis of the data. So, after creating the data set, we started to analyze the data. Our intention in the first approach was to cluster the whole data sets. This was a kind of problematic. We found that a conventional clustering algorithm can cluster 10,000 samples in a reasonable amount of time and memory consumption. So therefore, we found a workaround, firstly to cluster 10,000 samples in the first step, then to label 10,000 samples with the obtained clusters and to train classifier, a decision tree in this case. And we used the classifier to label the rest of the data set. So in the second approach, we compared absolute mode codings. For that purpose, we created the similarity function. This function is based on the Levenstein distance. It will be shown later on the slides. So, and finally, we grouped the jobs together by, so we grouped the jobs with the highest similarity together. So and here are some results. That are results of clustering by means of general purpose machine learning algorithms. So, and we tested different epsilon values. So since the clustering works on Euclidean distance and training data was normalized with mean max scalar, the values of the features used for this clustering were between 0 and 1. So using this information and the dimensionality of the data set, we can compute a reasonable epsilon values. So epsilon values is between 0 and 1.2 for job I/O duration and 0 and 1.4 for job metrics. So here, in the gray boxes, you can see that there are large amount of clusters. Here on the left and the top, you can see about 1,500 clusters if you use the epsilon value 0.1. So it is quite a lot, so too much for our purpose. But if we use a higher epsilon value, we get less clusters. So for job metrics, for example, on the right side, on the bottom, with the epsilon value 1.3, we obtain 59 clusters. So this is a good number, but it's a little bit disappointing because these clusters, they are polluted with samples from other clusters. Okay. In the end, we couldn't find a good epsilon value. So again, if you use a small epsilon value, we get too many clusters. If you use a high epsilon value, we get a poor clustering results. So labeling is also difficult because the clusters are polluted. So it's not possible to provide a correct label. So grouping the jobs by Levenstein distance is also disappointing. We created this similarity function. Similarity function produces, so a low Levenstein distance produces high similarity. So and Levenstein distance is the number of changes that are required to convert one word to another. Here's an example. For example, if you want to convert Saturday to Sunday, we need to change three letters, but we can also apply this distance to our codings. So so what happened is, so we grouped, so we computed similarities for all jobs and grouped them and ended up in 19,000 clusters. So this is too much. So it was a little bit disappointing result. So after all the trying, so the general purpose machine learning algorithm didn't produce the desired results. So therefore, we started to develop a new custom algorithm, which is tailored to our data. It worked on hexadecimal coding and relies heavily on the face matching. Fortunately, faces are trivial to obtain, but matching is a little bit computer intensive at the moment, as we will see later. And jobs with high similarity are put in the same cluster. So, and the last step. So, here's an here's an example. So, how it works. So, let's look at the face matching. So, how to compute face similarity. So, face matching is a kind of sliding window approach. The shorter face is compared to the corresponding part in the longer face. In the example illustrates the approach. So, assume we have two faces. So, there are in this case, there are three possibilities how we can combine the phases. So, we compute similarity for each combination and choose the highest one. In this case, this is the second combination. I think the exact formula of how they are computed is not really as important. But important is that we have to do this sliding window approach and test all combinations, which is quite compute intensive. So, and the next step is to find the job similarity. So the job similarity, jobs can have different number of phases. Here again, we have to find the best combination. So in this example, the last combination is obviously the best one. So, okay, but okay, this is so we have to do a lot of trying, but fortunately, the phases lengths are and the number of phases are short, and this approach isn't computationally infeasible. So, in the test run, we could successfully compare 580,000 jobs, but custom results are not available at the moment. It's my fault. I use absolute mode codings instead of hexadecimal codings. So, and it didn't work. But I will put the results in the paper if somebody is interested. So, but what I did, I looked at the robustness of the approach, and to check the robustness, I took two job codings. So each job consists of two phases. So, and in this scenario, we have a slow file system and the fast file system, and to run the same application on the file systems. So in the coding, the second coding has lower numbers. So because the file system is slower and the phases are a little bit longer because the phases take more time for the I/O. So, and if you look what happens, so if you use the approach and compare the similarity of two coordinates, you get a similarity of 75%. So and in this scenario, I changed 50% of this segment. So I don't know if it is good or bad. I think I will see this in the next test run. So the open question is here: how coding changes during the file system fluctuations, of course. So I don't know if the scenario is realistic or not. So this was my last slide. So we created data sets that can be downloaded from Git repo, and neat machine learning didn't work as expected. So we didn't find optimal clustering parameters. Maybe we had wrong features, I don't know exactly, but I think we use algorithm or we create some algorithm that is tailored to our data that works much better than the general purpose machine learning algorithms. So thank you for your attention.
Well, thanks, Eugen. Let me only add one thing to it, right? So the goal with this epsilon and so on is really instead of relying like we saw in the work that Carty has presented, where you know this is this type of job or is this type of application name, and that's how we do the matching. Here the idea is more we try to group jobs based on the I/O behavior, and then we could have a look, for instance, and say, oh, these are the same application, or they are different applications that still express the same I/O behavior. In that sense, the epsilon is really important because for me as a support member, if I'm in the support, yeah, I want to see jobs that have a problem, and if they have a problem, they have a high number in this code, the way the coding has been chosen. And if they have a high number, then I'm interested to say, okay, I see this is a single job that has a problem, but let's see if there are other jobs that behave like it, and maybe this kind of group of users that are then looking at this kind of jobs, they need education. Bye, Matthew. Yeah, so that's basically what the idea. So I think it's clear that the number of clusters really depends, and even a cluster number of 280 or big epsilon is still reasonable because you may have 280 different kind of I/O profiles, right? For across hundreds of thousands of jobs. Easy.
Yes, but if there are so many profiles that we have to find another way, so to do some automatic labeling or something.
Yes, you could have just increased it further, right? Like epsilon 2 or 3. I mean, 60 clusters are surely good enough to look at if they are inefficient, and then to start digging in.
But I think since we understand our data, we can create our own algorithm. I think that this is simple math. So I understand this. So better than I don't know, decision trees or something, or not.
Oh,
or
sure. Thank you.
Okay, but thank you for your feedback, you, Julian.
Yeah, sure. Let's see if someone else has something else to say.
Yeah.
You got here this link. That's there.
Yeah, this is Jay. I wanted to ask. I see how what you're doing is different than some of the other machine learning kind of approaches. Do you think that ultimately you can get a level of accuracy that is something that we can really use in production and trust? Or are you finding what the bounds are and saying because of the inherent chaos in the machines, because of things like command line use and off-platform use that there's some bound to how good these things can get?
Well, it's difficult to say. Of course, my goal of it is to create a robust approach, a robust clustering algorithm that everybody can use. So, but I don't know. It's how difficult that is. I have to do some investigations on file system fluctuations and things such that, and it requires more research. I would say I cannot answer this question.
Yeah, I just know that.
Go ahead. You hear the second one, right? This is the example we extensively discussed. So what happens if you run a job, the same job over and over again, right? You would natively assume that the metric that you have done, that this, you know, links closer, it's closer together than if you run something totally different, right?
And right.
And but the length of the phase, so the phases may be shifted, the overall job may run longer, which may lead to lower values of each individual point. And that's actually the reason why Eugen looks or has looked and still looking at these different metrics. Like for Levenstein, right, you then see, okay, the job is, yeah, I have to add something at the beginning and the end, and I can pad it together. And then you can also use the other metrics where you just compute the difference between one time step basically and another one. So it is tricky, I would say. But the goal is, as you say, exactly to cover those things. But epsilon should be determined by the user. If they say this is not close enough, fine.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. I mean, I'm quite interested in this. We thought about this and we didn't do anything. And the thought came from a US company that sells it's quite interesting. They sell an energy monitor, which you clamp onto your electricity supply, and it looks at the, you know, quite fine resolution the current demand within your house. And then they use machine learning algorithms to work out, based on that demand, what appliances you have. So they'll say, you know, you've got light bulbs and a fridge and a TV and things like that. So I thought, okay, that's interesting, because that means we could use a similar approach and look at, as you say, look at the timeline of the I/O metrics and try to infer what the application is from that. But we weren't so interested in the clustering side of it. We're more interested in saying if we know for particular applications or streams of applications or a user's jobs, how they behave, then we try to look for anomalous behavior. So that was the angle we wanted to go towards, but we never did anything. We had no time to do it. And Carthy went to a workshop, in fact, where he was talking about LASSI last year, and he shared a link to some other work we became aware of where people have been trying to use machine learning models to classify applications on an HPC system. So you might be interested in that.
Oh, yes. Let's take a look. Thank you.